Hello, I'm Richard Swan, and welcome to Platts Commodity Pulse. Renewable energy is moving rapidly into the mainstream of the European power industry. No longer a niche generation source, the market share of renewables is growing. Joining me today to assess how quickly costs are falling and the rate of progress towards making renewables competitive with other energy sources are David Jones, editor of Renewable Energy Report, and Henry Edwards Evans, managing editor of Power in Europe. David, I'd like to start with you if we could. We've seen the market share rise, as I said in the introduction, and we've seen costs fall. How close are we to getting to what is called grid parity, where renewable energy can compete with electricity from coal or natural gas without any subsidies?
For onshore wind, it's moving very rapidly towards grid parity. Some analysts think we'll be realizing it within 5 years or so in Europe. The costs are declining tremendously and the efficiency is improving rapidly. Offshore wind, that's a separate matter. The technology is much newer and it has yet to be tested to a great extent in a marine environment. But it holds great potential because the wind blows harder offshore and blows more frequently.
Already we're seeing that wind output in some of the markets where it's really increased its presence has forced prices right down to zero and beyond. Earlier this year and over the new year, on very quiet demand days, German and Spanish wind can meet almost all demand. And what we've seen in Germany recently are periods of negative prices where there's so much wind output that scheduling becomes really hard for the utilities, and they actually require users to buy electricity at negative prices. So they're actually giving you money to take electricity off them so that they avoid the penalties of misscheduling their systems.
Well, that's really interesting, and I can see how wind makes up the biggest chunk of renewables energy in a lot of countries like Germany. How close is solar, though? Oh, we read a lot about solar. Is solar close to making the same kind of inroads into the mainstream as wind?
Solar, of course, started much later than wind and is only really suitable for the southern European markets. But having said that, Germany is the largest solar market in Europe, and the growth has been really much quicker than we saw in the wind sector. So solar's really catching up quickly. Solar photovoltaic panels are being established on roofs and on ground-based level incredibly quickly, and it's hoovering up all the subsidies that are available for renewables, which is a bit of an issue for the subsidy systems because you get this imbalance between the growth rates. So what we're seeing with solar is very fast, significant growth. The input into the system isn't so significant yet, but we're seeing already traders in Germany talking about the solar season. So during the high radiation months during summer, we're seeing a fair amount now of electricity coming from PV panels in the south, and that is actually having an effect on power price. So it's not only the wind in Germany that's affecting the power price now. Now you're getting solar coming in and having a significant impact. In Italy, where the conditions are really much more ideal and the radiation levels are much higher, you're seeing solar actually surpassing wind, where they haven't established quite such a big wind farm fleet. In Spain as well, you're seeing some very big 50-watt, megawatt ground-based solar electrothermal plants being opened and a lot of PV going in the ground. So, you know, it's growing quickly and it's establishing itself. It's not ideal for all northern European markets, but we are seeing a lot of money thrown at solar.
And how competitive is it, David? How's the cost side of the solar looking?
Well, in a country like Italy, southern Italy, it's moving rapidly towards grid parity. What characterizes the solar photovoltaics industry is rapidly declining equipment costs. They've dropped about 70% in the past 10 years. They continue to drop. And what this produces is a paradox in the solar industry. On the one hand, you've got equipment manufacturers who are having their profit margins squeezed because they can't get as much as they could before for the equipment they sell. On the other hand, the developers, the people who are actually putting in the solar panels, are finding it's cheaper and cheaper to sell their products.
What about other renewable sources? I mean, solar and wind seem to be the big two. What else should we be looking at, should we be looking out for? Which ones perhaps are a bit overblown?
Well, looking down the road, wave and tidal power have been around for a while. They're still being tested, and they're still working out the kinks. There have been deployments of wave energy systems, say, off the coast of Portugal a couple years ago, but they have a very tough time operating in the harsh marine environment. We're several years away, maybe several decades away, from seeing wave and tidal power really come into their own.
What about biomass, though? Don't read so much about it. It's maybe not quite so glamorous, but it's a bit of a dark horse.
Yes, I mean, it's less easy to envisage as a pure renewables because often it's being used to co-fire coal-fired power stations. So you can co-fire coal and biomass to the extent that biomass replaces about 15% of your coal without really having to invest in your power station much at all. And actually, when you think of the size of a coal-fired power station and the fact that it's running at base load, operating all the time, that can meet a fair amount of your renewable target. So that is developing in markets like the Dutch market, the UK market, and the German market. We've seen a fair amount of co-firing of biomass. We've seen utilities buying into wood pellet making facilities in the States and then shipping those across to the European market. And then now we're seeing in the UK some dedicated biomass projects coming forward and trying to get financed. So as well as co-firing the biomass, we're seeing development of dedicated power stations up to about 300 megawatts, so significant in size, that can actually balance the growth in intermittent renewables. And this is the key for biomass. Biomass can operate like a conventional power station. You can ramp it up and down. Ideally, you're running it at base load. It's reliable, it apes the old conventional grid system. It can sit near the transmission lines and can be dispersed to the areas of load.
Let me ask you about political support, which I think has been absolutely key to the growth in renewables over the last decade or more. Can we expect this to continue? Is it a given? I mean, if you think about how poor current economies are across Europe, the parlous state of public sector finances, can they really afford to continue this level of support to renewable energy?
Well, you're right. We've seen cross-party support for renewables across Europe across several administrations for several years. And essentially, that has to continue until these 2020 targets are met comfortably. What we are seeing just emerging now are some austerity policies whereby subsidies are coming down. Now, they need to come down to reflect the falling price of capital cost for putting these things in the ground. So that's logical, and that will then get us closer to grid parity. Some utilities don't think that's going fast enough. Others obviously want the subsidy to remain high and to continue while they're throwing a lot of their capital at these very expensive projects still. So in the worst hit of the European countries like Spain and Italy, we're now seeing that the amount of renewables added each year is being capped, and also the feed-in tariffs that support those technologies are being stepped down quite significantly. So for instance, in Italy we've seen a big drop in solar photovoltaic subsidies by about 50% over a number of years, and then will be stepped down at 10, 12, 15% year on year. Same in Germany. And now in Spain we're hearing the new minister saying we've got enough renewables because they're so far ahead of the curve. Okay. Now that indicates to a lot of people that in fact they're really going to clamp down.
Let me ask you about one of the things that often crops up, and it's one of the practical obstacles to renewables getting a bigger market share. And you both touched on this issue already. It's intermittency. It's not always sunny. We won't always have solar power. It's not always windy. The turbines won't always be going around. How can we get around that? It strikes me one of the areas that policymakers are looking at increasingly is this issue of interconnection. So you may essentially make your national grid linked to other countries. You get a bigger grid, it's going to be sunny somewhere. Is that part of the solution?
Absolutely. What we're seeing is a rapid integration of the European market. Transmission across borders, connections between countries. Denmark, for instance, gets maybe a quarter of its power from wind power, but it counts on the balancing of baseload hydropower from Scandinavia to make that wind efficient. We have seen connections between countries increase, But there are a lot of difficulties in making that happen. For instance, we've seen in France and Spain, they've been trying for several decades to build an interconnector between them. And it's proven very difficult. They're finally getting it underway. But it just shows how difficult it is sometimes to make these things happen.
The supergrid is the interesting one for me, because that's going to connect up offshore all the offshore wind farms that have been built in the North Sea. It's at a nascent stage right now, but it looks logical because you've got some very big investments going on right now connecting quite far offshore wind farms to the mainland continent in Germany, in the Netherlands, and of course the UK is leading the offshore drive. Those are very expensive projects. It makes a lot of sense to link them up somehow and to get that power ashore. As Dave mentioned earlier, offshore wind is a lot more predictable than onshore wind. That's going to help balance the system. In addition, you've got interconnectors between the Scandinavian countries, UK, Netherlands, Germany, that are in the planning process that will bring that hydropower from Scandinavia down to the intermittent markets of continental Europe. So there's a lot of things that you can do to ameliorate the impact of growing wind. Another thing that the manufacturers of wind turbines are doing is modifying and developing the technology so that they can be stepped up and down in a more predictable way. So the ramping up and down of turbines in difficult wind conditions is now improving to the extent that the system can adapt and react over a longer period than was the case before.
So if we manage to solve the problem of intermittency, particularly with offshore wind, that must remove one of the big obstacles to further growth. I mean, where can we expect renewables to go from here?
I think we can expect renewables to continue this incredible revolution. I think we're going to see them continue to grow because essentially they're relatively small investments compared to the really massive commitments that the alternative is, i.e. new nuclear reactors, new coal plant with carbon capture and storage. These are huge, huge, very long-term investment commitments. So while we're going through this period of low demand, weak market signals, low prices, I think we're going to see a continuation of growth in renewables, even if it steps back a little bit because of the austerity. They will continue to be put in the ground, and that will then further delay decisions, difficult decisions, on those really big ticket items. So over a very long period, we might see renewables get to the point where actually the decisions are less hard to take on those big ticket items because they actually go away. They're not needed anymore.
Well, that would be interesting. I suspect that would make a lot of policymakers very happy if they didn't have to make some of those decisions. Thank you both very much for joining me today. We could go on more, but that's plenty for today. That's it for this edition of Platts Commodity Pulse. Thanks for watching.